Well, hello there. It's Wednesday today, and I've had two nights' sleep. I've had a good night's sleep on Monday night after my drive, and then another good sleep last night. So I'm beginning to get back to normal, and it's just a matter of now to get out of this situation that you find yourself in when you've been on a ship for such a long time. The only thing I can describe it as is being institutionalised. I would get up every day at the same time. I would finish work every day at the same time, mostly. And I would also do my duties every third day. And so that routine would be set in as well. On every third day, I'd have to do get up early, go to bed late, do my rounds in the evening and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, so I'm back home. And, life without a dog has been pretty dreadful, really. I wake up every morning with a sense of loss now because, I come down to the kitchen and there's no little boy there to meet me, sniffing around my ankles and wanting to be picked up. It's been quite traumatic, really. I don't know if you hear that, but that's a dishwasher going. Just wait for that to finish. Yes, it's, every time I stood up from the settee, the dog would be in my seat, taking up the warmth. He's not there anymore. But people have been quite kind. Somebody gave us a cushion with pictures on. That was taken at Christmas time. That was taken last year. That was taken when we first had him, when he tore up the kitchen floor for us, when we had fireworks went off one night and he decided he was going to rip up all the lino. Anyway, but yeah, somebody also gave us a cup as well. So that was quite nice. It's been, for me, it was quite traumatic on the first few days before I went back to sea. And then while I was at sea, because it's, like you say, you're institutionalised, you kind of get used to not being there. Nothing was changed when I went there. So it was hard, in that respect that I wasn't seeing him. But my wife, I've never seen anyone so upset as Sarah when we lost the dog. She spent literally 3 days crying her eyes out. It was her pride and joy, our Boston. Absolutely, our pride and joy. And we now have some pictures up of him. And we have a little tiny, we've made his plastic bed. We've turned that into a planter in the garden with my father-in-law's carved his name on a piece of wood that won't rot. Apparently, this is some hardwood that he's got hold of. And he's carved his name into that, so that's there. And of course, we've filled it full of flowers, so that'll have something to remember him by. And of course, when the weather gets better, we'll do the rest of the garden to go around it. But yeah, Sarah had a bout of depression a couple of weeks ago. But yeah, just before I came home, I think the weekend before I came home, Sarah went to Crufts, not because we'd lost the dog and we were thinking about getting another one, but she'd booked this thing months in advance, before we even realised that something was wrong. Definitely way before the dog started to develop symptoms. As I said, at Christmas time he was fine, and then when I came home, he seemed a bit disorientated. So that was in January when I came home. He seemed a bit disorientated. He didn't want to be picked up. Anyway. So from then it was just a month before he went. But yeah, it is very sad losing an animal. And I do appreciate the fact that nobody has said it was just a dog, because they're not just a dog. They are part of the family. They are They are part of the family. They're like your children. You, okay, yes, the children come first, and the dog would come second. And but you know, it's they are, well, they are family, really, adopted family. But yeah, we're all getting used to it, and now we're all getting over it. So Sarah's had 2 months to get over this. Well, not quite 2 months, but getting on for 6 weeks now. She's been able to adjust, and of course now I've come back into it again, and not having him around is, you know, I do turn around expecting to see him, but he's not there. So that's a shame. It is a real pity, but well, that's one of the things I suppose you've got to accept when you have an animal that has a 15 to 20 year lifespan. Ours was a Boston, and they have between 10 to 15 years lifespan. And unfortunately, he succumbed to something rather nasty, and he went after 10 years. And of course, if you have insurance, pet insurance, I would cancel it straight away because it's a bit of a scam. Now, my pet insurance, we paid £60 a month, roughly, for pet insurance. And when it finally came to it, we put in a bill for £203 for euthanasia, and it was £195 for crematorium fees. Having him cremated was £195, so the best part of £400. So we put in a claim for the euthanasia fee, and the pet insurance people told me at the time, they said, we'll cover the bill, they said, but you're going to have to pay the remainder of your policy, which was £117. So I said, well, okay, that sounds reasonable. Well, not reasonable, if you know what I mean. I was expecting them to pay the whole lot. But no, they said, you're going to have to pay £117 for the remainder of the policy. And so we'll give you, your claim will be about £80. So I thought, well, okay, I'll get £80 back, which is better than nothing. But no, that's not the case. In the small print in the policy, you have to pay £125 excess on the policy, then some other fee on top of that, which come to another £39 on top of that. You know, so really, it's not worth anything. Your pet insurance, if you've got to put your dog down, is worth absolutely nothing. So the best thing I could have done was not have paid it. If I put that money aside for emergencies, then I would have been better off if I'd paid all these things myself. And of course, the vets are a rip-off, aren't they? £203 for an injection, which I've been told is about £3.50, you know, and 15 minutes of the vet's time, most of that was spent out the back while we were grieving, is quite a lot of money. So it's a real rip-off. So it's out of this, I think I've got £26 back from the insurance people to cover the death of the dog that cost me £400. Even the crematorium people are, you know, tiny wooden casket can't have cost more than £20. You know, it's just a rip-off. So my advice is, if you have pet insurance, cancel it now, but keep the money in a high interest bank account, if there is anything, if there is such a thing as a high interest bank account, and use that money to treat your dog if it does come to the worst. And of course, one of the bad things was as well that the insurance would have paid me £500 if my dog had been under 9 years old. For the death of a dog under 9 years old was £500, but our dog was only a few months over 9 years old. I think he was November, his birthday was, and he died in in the January. So, yeah, he wasn't that much over 9 years old. But of course, it all adds to the trauma, doesn't it? Being told that one minute you can get some money back after spending all that money, all those 10 years worth of pet insurance, and then not getting anything back, and going through the hassle of thinking that you're going to get something, to try and offset the cost of the casket and the funeral. Well, not the funeral, but the cremation for the dog. It was quite traumatic having to go through that. But such is life. But that is the downside of owning a dog. It's bracing yourself for the grief at the end. And it will probably take us a good few years before we get another dog, if we do get another dog. But it won't be until I'm retired. So that might be in a few years' time, or it could be in a few months' time. I'm beginning to make inroads. But we'll talk about that on another day. Anyway, so hopefully I won't put in the mid-adverts again. I think I forgot to take them out last time. But hopefully I'll take the mid-adverts out and get this video uploaded. Okay, see you later. Thank you.